Good morning, afternoon, evening, everybody. Like I said, my name is David Groves. I am a policy researcher at the RAND Corporation and co-director of our Center on Decision-Making Under Uncertainty. And I'm really happy to be moderating this session on COVID-19 response and recovery. This is the second of two sessions. The first session was on Tuesday morning, and you should be able to catch those presentations, the recorded presentations, at a later date. So today we're going to continue that conversation, and just to sort of bring everybody up to the same place, I just want to offer a few thoughts on why we're talking about COVID-19 in a conference about decision making under deep uncertainty. Because, as you know, those of you who've been to these meetings or have been in the field for a while, will certainly know that oftentimes when we're thinking about deep uncertainty, we're also thinking about longer term challenges like water resources planning or climate change adaptation and mitigation or investments in transportation or other infrastructure. And you know, we've seen over the years that, you know, those types of problems have the type of uncertainty that can't be characterized very easily probabilistically, and these new DMDU techniques provide real value to guiding the development of robust strategies. However, as I think you'd all agree, the progression of the COVID-19 pandemic is also deeply uncertain. We have uncertainty about how it how the actual infections are propagating through the population. The graph on the left is just showing, as of Tuesday morning, the trajectory of cases from February to November. This is showing the global cases, but if you look at any local locality or region or whatnot, you'll see that there are spikes and dips, and there's just a lot of dynamic behavior in how this disease has progressed. And that's both from the nature of the disease and how it spread, but also the response to the disease. There's a lot of uncertainty about how people respond to both people and governments respond, whether it's the type of restrictions on economic and social activity that governments might put in place and then remove, as well as behaviors of mask wearing, and lastly, there's the promise of a new vaccine. Just on Tuesday, Eli Lilly announced a vaccine that's reportedly 90% effective. So, it'll take, of course, a while to roll that out. And some of the presentations on Tuesday looked at what the implications of having a vaccine would be on the progression of the disease. The punchline is it helps, but it doesn't make it all go away. And there's still an awful lot of policymaking to be done, even with a vaccine in play. So today we're going to hear from three folks that are going to talk about different aspects of the problem. We'll start with Dr. Warren Walker, who's going to, look back at what we've learned from COVID-19, and this should be a really nice framing for the rest of the discussion. Jack Mitchum will, from what I can sense, maybe go into a little bit more technical detail on how do we actually can evaluate mitigation strategies in COVID-19, and then we'll round out the discussion with Emilia Fieo, who's going to look at a particular condition in Mexico and how the pandemic has progressed there. So each speaker will have about 15 minutes to present and take a few questions, and that should leave maybe five minutes at the end for a discussion. So with that, let me just introduce Dr. Warren Walker. Here's by his bio. I'll just mention that he's a professor emeritus at Delft University of Technology. He's one of the very early pioneers of decision-making under deep uncertainty methods, having worked at RAND for many, many years, and then at Delft as well. And I will now ask him to take control of the presentation, and then we will hear from him.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I did this paper with Vincent Marchaud of Radboud University, and George de Hoyer contributed a piece. He's at Erasmus. Three parts to the talk. First, why we need a new policy-making paradigm to handle things like pandemics. Adaptive policies as a possible, well, I learned in the previous session, I shouldn't say solution, I should say, strategy or something, because it doesn't necessarily solve the problem. And then we'll talk about four phases in an approach. So current policy making, as we saw in most countries, was lockdown and then do tracking and tracing and maybe prepare for the worst case, although the US was not prepared for a worst case. But there are social and economic consequences of doing a lockdown. They are unprecedented, and we saw pushback, people not following, people rioting, in fact. And if you prepare for the worst case, you might overspend or underspend, and who knows what the worst case is. So we have a problem, as David introduced, of deep uncertainty in five ways, dynamics especially. It's a changing situation every day. You see on the TV, you know, new statistics, new facts. The spread is totally uncertain within a region. How fast, which groups, how bad. The outcomes, we still don't know how to measure them. We're trying to, but again, because of the dynamics, it's hard to measure outcomes on the economy, for example, and health, on education. I'm a little worried about my grandson, who's distance learning, might not be as good as in school learning. Working, we see all these changes, and they're changing every day. And it's very hard to make trade-offs among the outcomes. As we see in the United States, the president is trying to focus on the economy and not health. And in some countries, they focus on health and they're worried that it's going to hurt the economy and is hurting. So, and then there's uncertainty about who should be involved in decision-making, which jurisdictions, what are their priorities? So it's a deep uncertainty problem, like we've been discussing in other sessions at this conference. We all know the traditional paradigm. You propose a policy, the policy analysis approach, identify how it might fail, and then, make sure you protect it. But in the initial implementation, what we say is you need a new feedback loop to keep circling around and watching the changing situation as events occur, knowledge gained. So a DMDU approach is needed. I'm going to talk about four phases of a new approach. Be prepared, monitor, act, and recover. And that's not the end. You then have feedback. You can go in different directions. It's not over when you do your preparation and monitoring and acting. You probably need to feedback. So what does be prepared mean? It requires, and in all these cases I'm going to be talking about, we see how it wasn't done and how it could have been done. So not enough hospital spaces, not enough hospital workers, insufficient supplies, logistics to distribute them, and organization for the implementation of any policy measures. Again, the US is a perfect case study of how not to do these things. But policy analysis can help by building a system model at multiple interacting geographic levels, then at each level, identifying a range of options, not a single optimal option, and then make decisions on the plan, setting priorities, using systems analysis to set up, and this is very important too, because we didn't see it in the United States, an integrated cooperative system where you have everybody working together, not doing their own thing. So that's the be prepared. Then you have to watch as things change, because as I said, it's a dynamic situation, and you should implement the monitoring system before people start dying. You should know what you need in order to do monitoring, what data, and set up a system for gathering data centrally and some coordination. Look at the vulnerabilities of any policy that you have thought about, and specifying triggers to adapt the policy when the tipping point is reached in some of the measures, some of the things you're monitoring, and you have contingent actions already, you've thought about them, so that when you do hit a tipping point, you can trigger something you thought about and not start thinking, oh boy, we're in trouble. Information sharing is very important among jurisdictions and all the relevant parties, the businesses, the school system, etc. And then, as we have seen, hotspots are identified and they move around. New York State was the first hotspot, and it became a very quick success story. But it's moved around, and now the middle of the United States that had nothing at the beginning is in deep trouble. So you look all the time, you're monitoring. And then you act. You have these preparatory actions that you made in phase one. You have the monitoring program that you developed in phase two, and you have the contingency actions that can be triggered as the pandemic evolves. So things like isolating hotspots early, sending supplies and personnel where needed based on the monitoring, expanding the implementation geographically and as the situation evolves. Continuing the monitoring and changing based on the adaptive plans designed in phases one and two. So be prepared, it's the key. Some people ask me, you know, we have a 400 page book and they want a quick summary. I say, were you a Boy Scout? Yes. What's the motto? Be prepared. I said, that's the book. So now we have implemented all these things and life progresses, the virus progressive, and you have this information gathering system that you've set up already, and you look then at the data. You look at the diagnostic testing, the results from the tests, the hospitalizations, the contact tracing, and now they're talking about antibody testing. All of this is data. These are metrics, and you should be prepared to do things with these data. And then also, hopefully, you plan for an exit when the city or the nation or the town opens up and gets back to what they're now calling, and I think we will see, it's a new normal. It won't be the same as the old days. And gets prepared for the next pandemic. In the Netherlands, because they have serious flooding problems, in order to stay prepared, the prayer of Dutch water managers is, please give us our daily, rain or water and the occasional small flooding, so we can test our systems. That's the idea. Why can't I see the whole slide? Maybe I can, I can move that. Okay. Real life examples. As of November 11th, 2020, a couple of days ago, South Korea had 5 deaths per million population. The US had 745 deaths per million. An even more dramatic example of the potential success of the four-phase approach. And the explanation for both South Korea and you'll see Vietnam is they followed more or less what I suggested as the four phases. Vietnam, as of November 11th, it had only 1,252 confirmed cases. They have many million population. It's not a very small country. And they had 35 deaths. They had 0.4 of a death per million versus 745 in the United States. And even 5 in South Korea, 0.4 per million. Why? The success of Vietnam and also South Korea came from acting fast, and 3 key tactics used widely in Vietnam, especially temperature screening and testing, targeted lockdowns, constant communication from day one, not from 6 months later. So to conclude, the problem, high risk of implementing a wrong policy or getting the timing wrong due to large uncertainties related to policy outcomes, evaluation, and possible other external developments. So there, the conditions are exactly right for deep uncertainty conditions. So what's the challenge? To develop approaches for moving forward while handling all these uncertainties. And that's why DMDU, that's where DMDU comes in. A DMDU adaptive policy makes you prepared, gets implementation underway, allows adaptations of the policy over time as knowledge about the COVID-19 is gained, as values change, and as other external events take place that were unexpected, unplanned for, will happen though. And it enables learning from experience over time. These are the strengths of DMDU approaches. Thank you very much for your attention. And thanks to my co-authors.
Great, thank you so much, Warren. That was a really great overview and a nice summary of how DMDU ought to be used for pandemic planning and recovery. We have about 1 minute left. If there's anybody wants to ask a question, I think you could probably just start speaking. All right, well, why don't we do this? Why don't we head to the next presentation, and then that will leave enough time to kind of talk about all three together in a discussion. So thanks again. Let me quickly introduce Jack. Jack, you already took over the screen. That's perfect. I'll just mention that Jack's a PhD student at the College of Management at the University of Massachusetts, Boston. Jack, please take it away.
So I'm going to talk about a multi-attribute utility function to evaluate COVID-19 mitigation strategies. I am working on this paper with my PhD advisor, Jeffrey Kiesler. The first step of this is I'm using multi-attribute utility theory instead of many objective optimization, which a lot of other researchers in DMDU are using. So the idea is to compress all the different decision criteria into one utility number, as opposed to when you're using many objective optimization, you are you end up with a kind of a Pareto frontier of options to choose from. This can help you decide between the options on the frontier of the of the optimal solutions, because you're making your trade-offs explicit, exactly how many deaths versus what kind of economic impacts would you deem acceptable. we've all seen this definition of deep uncertainty. The key part here is the end of it, so which consequences to consider and their relative importance. As we've seen with COVID-19, this is really a big part of the disagreements on what to do as far as mitigating the disease. But we can apply robust decision-making to the range of consequences to consider and the different weights to put on those. This talks about the two parts. The main part of it is developing the utility function. I also have an epidemiological economic model to demonstrate how this utility function can be used. However, it's kind of a rudimentary model. The model that Rand put together that was presented in the first half of the session is probably, it's going to be a more detailed model than what I'm having, than what I have, but it's not, the exact model isn't the point, because there's uncertainty in which the functional form of the model, what's right and what's not. But the point is, this utility function can be used to evaluate almost any model. So there are a few key trade-offs. I've identified three criteria. One is a life or lives lost, or a life years lost. So not just the number of lives, but how many life years are lost as well. One thing I have that a lot of the other researchers don't have is a liberty cost. This is actually a pretty big deal, much bigger than maybe we would have expected a year ago. That wearing a mask, for example, is now a contentious issue that some people value very highly, not having to wear a mask. So I'm explicitly incorporating this into the trade-offs. And then there's the economy. So it's not only the economic cost of the countermeasures, but also the economic cost of just letting the virus run free. The key part is that there is not one correct answer. You cannot say a life or a life here is worth this many dollars exactly. And if you're a dollar or two above that or below that, you're wrong. That it doesn't work that way. There's a very wide range of plausible values you can put on these different criteria. So the utility function, it's a linear utility function. But basically, you want to maximize the value of life, value of liberty, and the economic value. These are all going to be kind of negative numbers because it's kind of lives or life years lost, or liberty lost, and economic damage kind of. So it's all kind of negative numbers. You want the least negative numbers, you're still maximizing. The life economy trade-off is possibly the most interesting one, and there's a lot of literature that exists on this. Valuing a year of life is something that is actually routinely done in the government. And in medicine and so on. For example, there is the quality adjusted life year that has a dollar value that's often put on by like insurance companies and things like that. And those tend to range from like $100,000 to $300,000 per life year if you're, that would be considered efficient. Then there's the value of the statistical life, which is used by the Department of Transportation. That by itself is not a perfect measure for this because we're not losing random people to COVID-19 that tend to affect certain age groups more than others. So the actual number of life years lost is not necessarily average, but we can kind of extrapolate that or interpolate that to get a value per year. And then Ralph Keeney actually did a lot of work on kind of flipping the script and saying, okay, not how much is a life worth in dollars, but how many dollars of economic damage or how many dollars of loss will statistically cause a death? And looking at it that way, you can get numbers. The neat thing is all of these values end up being somewhere in the same order of magnitude. Now that's still a huge range. And for valuing a year of life, I put a range from anywhere from $50,000 to $500,000 per year. But it's not going down to $1, it's not going up to $10 million per life year. It's kind of constrained in a certain range. This is a big range, but it's finite, which is nice. In addition to just how many life years are lost due to COVID, we may consider that a life lost to COVID has value by itself even if they would have otherwise died from cancer a year later, for example. Just the circumstances of the death matter, and that can have its own value. For example, if there's a murder victim, we don't calculate how many qualities they had left in determining the punishment. There is some kind of inherent value to losing a life in a particular way. So those two will be combined into kind of how much you value a life in terms of economic cost. There's also a life-liberty trade-off. And this has some pretty natural bounds, I believe. A year of fully restricted liberty shouldn't be valued more than a year of life. Being under a quarantine for COVID-19 is not worse than death. You might not want to consider liberty at all. So it's feasible that you put the weight on the utility function of liberty at zero. And that might be okay. But it certainly can't be more than how much you value life. And then we have to kind of make estimates for partial restrictions on liberty. For example, what percent of a liberty restriction is having to wear a mask in public? And that's not, there's not a hard number for that, but we can say it's probably not more than 10%. In my research here, I used 5%, but I've done sensitivity analysis on that number anywhere from 1% to 10%. And it comes with similar results. The last part is kind of an implied trade-off between the economy and liberty. It's implied from the other two, and it gives you a kind of a willingness to pay or willingness to accept metric. Now, economic value is not the same thing as getting paid something personally, so it's not a perfect metric, but it gives some interesting numbers. For example, if you were to value a life year at $200,000, and you are someone who maximizes liberty such that you're going to value a year free at also $200,000. This is the kind of give me liberty or give me death type. And you're assuming that wearing a mask is about a 5% restriction of that liberty. That's kind of a value of wearing a mask of $10,000. I'm going to have a title there. Anyway, but would a person who maximizes liberty be willing to accept $10,000 to wear a mask for a year? Or would they be willing to pay $10,000 to avoid wearing a mask? And this is, it's plausible. It's not a crazy number. It's not saying $10 million or something like that. So it's kind of just a sanity check on whether or not this 5% value makes sense. Combining these, you end up with four archetypes. And this is very similar to what Dr. Lempert did in one of his talks, I think it was yesterday or 2 days ago. He called them worldviews. I was calling them value archetypes, but I actually think worldviews is better, and I may adopt that. So you got the archetype or worldview that you want to maximize life. So you crank the weights on the lives all the way to the top. You put that at 500,000 per life year and a couple million, per death. And then you minimize the value of liberty. You set that to zero. We don't care about liberty at all. We're just saving lives here. This ends up actually being kind of what a lot of the other research falls into because they don't consider liberty at all. The other way is maximizing liberty. So you minimize the value of life, say to 50,000 per life year, and then you just maximize liberty to that same dollar value. Then the economy is kind of a secondary concern. You can maximize the economy, which is the same thing as minimizing liberty and lives. Like, you don't care about people's freedom or saving their lives. You just want the economy to be strong. So you have the value per life year, 50,000, and the value of liberty at zero. And that's a plausible way to value things. Then you can minimize the economy. You want to maximize life and liberty. You don't care about the economy at all. This might be because you don't think that economic cost is relates to like underlying values that much, that you don't care about that dollar amount, and you don't think it reflects the value of life very well. Now, using these archetypes, we want to see what strategies are not only robust against different plausible characteristics that the pandemic, but also robust against the different ways to measure the outcomes. So when we are trying to come up with a mitigation strategy, which ones, okay, not only don't break if like R0 ended up being 6 or something crazy, but also which ones can these different archetypes kind of agree on? If a policy is agreed on by most people, it's more likely to work. So that's kind of the starting point for this. The decision frame I use for this research is just for the state of Massachusetts, because that's where I'm at. And I'm kind of looking at the beginning of COVID-19 when the parameters are most uncertain, but also that's when it's most important to have decisions made. To me, that's the most interesting time. A year in when we have a lot of data, the uncertainty gets shrunk a bit. And it's also an iterative process. It's designed to work with a team of politicians and experts alongside the policy analysts. This is not really just me telling people what needs to be done. This is designed to be an ongoing process, kind of in the RDM model. I think we've all seen that diamond. I should have had a picture here, where you analyze the weaknesses, and then you can recreate it. The model I used, a system dynamics model, and then I kind of attached the economic liberty models to it. I used the community coronavirus model by Tom Fiddeman on the system dynamics. I can't remember, but it was basically through Venison. And I added some parts. This is, we don't have time to go over all this. This would take a half hour by itself. But it's basically an SEIR model. It's nothing too complicated, despite how it looks. But this allowed me to plug in some policy levers. As for the parameters, there are 13 different parameters which are uncertain, and some of them are very highly uncertain, especially at the beginning. For example, R0 I had from 1.4 to 6.5, which is actually the range that the initial studies were coming in at. To cover all of these, I end up using a Monte Carlo simulation, and I'll get to that in a second. Also had 5 different mitigation strategies. The base is just doing nothing. Then I had wearing masks, a light lockdown, which was masks plus closing some things, a heavy lockdown, which is just even stricter. Then central quarantine, seems heavy lockdown, but you centrally quarantine infected individuals in the special facilities. You can mix and match these. This ended up being very computationally tricky and actually more difficult to explain if you have 11 different combinations of lockdown plus mask, or lockdown and no masks but central quarantine, and so on. So I just focused on these as a starting point, and then this can be iterated on later on. I did 100,000 model runs for each strategy. So it was 100,000 sets of parameters of the disease and model characteristics and mitigation strategy characteristics. And each strategy used the same one, so you could compare apples to apples. So it ended up being 500,000 data points. And I plugged it all into Tableau, which I can show you right here. Let's see, I might need to.
And Jack, you're going to switch. Need to wrap up in the next minute or two also.
Yes, I'm just about finished.
Okay, perfect.
Is this screen, did my Tableau screen come up, or do we need to share something separately? Hold on. I think I know. Here. Can you see this now? I'm assuming you can see this dashboard. Okay, cool. So the dashboard has filters for the different parameters of the disease. Like, let's say we know that R0 is not going to be 6.5, you can reduce this. What's shown right now is the cost per life year at minimized, and the hedonic value, which is liberty value, maximized. So this is someone with maximizing liberty. So even maximizing liberty, masks tends to be the best strategy. We also have the regret measure and so on. And this is designed that you can, let's say you wanted to maximize that and minimize liberty. This can be done with the policymakers and with the experts in kind of real time in the decision setting. Very quickly, I'll just go over a couple. Couple quick results, and this will be it. So mask mandates seem to be better than nothing. in almost every scenario, regardless of their worldview. The central quarantine dominates heavy lockdown entirely, regardless. So if you're going to do a heavy lockdown, you should never do it without central quarantine. Now, we didn't check central quarantine with any other combination. Let's say we only wear masks and centrally quarantine infected individuals. We could rerun the model combining mixing and matching. This is kind of the iterative process. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jack. Anyone have a 30-second or 10-second question? Okay, thank you. I just one comment. I'd be interested in thinking or hearing your thoughts maybe afterwards about, why not keep the different, show the Pareto frontier and then apply your utility function to suggest where you might want to select along that frontier, because in essence, it seems like the Tableau is giving you that information, but not in a frontier sort of format. So,
yeah, that's definitely something that can be done. It's just a different mathematical way to get to the same thing.
Right. Okay, great. Well, thank you so much. I want to jump over to the next presentation. All right. So the next talk is entitled Understanding COVID Mortality in Mexico, Causes and Policy Actions to Reduce It. Our speaker is Emilio Fueyo, and he's worked in government in Mexico and is a founding partner of Emanta, which seems to be a consultancy. I'm not sharing the screen. And with that, I will let Emilio take over and give his presentation.
Thank you very much, David. I will share my screen with you.
Great, we can see it.
Perfect. This is a paper I've been working with Jordi Rodriguez, which is also in this session. And as both Warren and Jack has mentioned in the previous presentations, there's a huge problem of uncertainty on what's causing a lot of COVID-related issues in the different countries. So this paper specifically has an objective to understand what are the main causes of mortality in Mexico, and also recommend some policy actions that could be reducing it. So it has four sections. First, we're going to do a brief introduction to the numbers in Mexico. Then some insights in the data on mortality. Then I'm going to show you the results of a probit model we developed. And at the end, we'll see the conclusions. Well, first of all, we need to look where Mexico is compared to other countries. We have the seventh place with the most deaths per million inhabitants. So it's a huge problem in Mexico. And mortality in Mexico, as Edmundo showed us on Tuesday, is one of the highest in the whole world. We have a case fatality rate of 10% compared to the world that is 2%. So we are five times worse than the rest of the world. To start understanding these numbers, a good approach is to see that there's different testing policies that affect on people that are registered in the data that the health officials are publishing. So we have a group of countries that restrict their testing only to people that show severe symptoms. So in order to get a test, you have to tell the doctor that you have a headache and that you have diarrhea or you lost smell. And if you don't have those symptoms, you don't get a test. So you're not in the database. Indeed, in this group, we have Mexico. And this group of countries tend to have higher positivity rates than other countries such as the US that have a more broader testing strategy. And they test people with severe symptoms, but also someone with no symptoms or mild symptoms can be tested. So we are using data from over 90,000 cases of people that have died from COVID in Mexico, and all of them had severe symptoms. So that's one of the reasons that we're going to see high fatality rates, because it's a sample of population that already had a severe a severe disease. Well, as well as in other countries, and as we are seeing in the US, we reached a peak at the starting the second semester of the year. Then cases started to fall, but since mid-September, cases started to rise again, and we are expecting that this trend continues during the winter, and we're not going to have the advantage that some of the countries in the southern hemisphere had that faced the flu while people were in a lockdown. Then we see in the graph at the middle the mortality of people that were hospitalized in Mexico. As you can see, it's really high levels. This means that around 4 out of 10 people that go into a hospital die from COVID. This trend is going down, but it's still really, really high levels. And the positivity rate continues to focus only on patients with severe symptoms, and that's why it has remained high, over 40% of positivity. This shows the characteristics of people that have died from COVID in Mexico. The graph at the left shows that 89% of people that died were hospitalized, and 11% the rest died at their home. Of all people that died, 30.8% were intubated, and only 10.2% got into an intensive care unit. This means that there's very few access to oxygen for people that are hospitalized in Mexico. We also have 70% of the deaths concentrated on people that had at least one comorbidity, but 27% had no comorbidities and they still died. And another problem that is a bigger problem when you have less or very restrictive access to oxygen in the hospital is that 73% of the people that died developed pneumonia before they passed out. As well as we have seen in other countries, comorbidities affect mortality a lot. In Mexico, the ones that are more present within people that die are renal insufficiency, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and cardiovascular diseases. Then probability of dying increases more when you are over 60 years old. Also, early medical care matters. The days that you wait since you start symptoms to attend to a medical unit also increase the probability of dying. And men appear to be at higher risk. There are several studies attributing these differences to psychological characteristics of men and women. Then another thing we've seen is that there's big difference in the effectiveness of different states in Mexico treating the different people that have COVID and another comorbidity. For example, people that have diabetes, if they are treated in Baja California, 58% of them die. But in Aguascalientes, it's 34%. So there are different medical protocols that are being used, and some states are more effective treating some people with some comorbidities than others. For another example, people with no comorbidities in the far right, in Baja California, 43% of them die. But in Nuevo León, only 22%. So we are seeing that there are practices in the state level that are really different, and we are starting to identify best practices. Another problem is in Mexico is that even though in the phase that Warren mentioned to be prepared, some states started implementing and putting more beds destined for COVID patients. But there's another restriction on the availability of doctors. The only state in Mexico that has enough doctors that could treat patients effectively is Mexico City. All the other states are in problems when they reach, for example, Jalisco, when they reach 40% capacity in their hospitals. They don't have enough doctors to treat with a certain reasonable parameter. Then also there's big difference within institutions. In Mexico, we have several health institutions. Most of them are public. The biggest one is IMSS. That is the one that we see in the table at the right upside corner. They are treating almost half of the patients with COVID. Then the one that says SSA are managed by the states. Then we have ISSSTE, which is the one that cares for all workers from government. We have private hospitals. SEDENA is the army hospitals. Pemex is the nation oil and gas company. They also have hospitals. And SEMAR are hospitals run by the Navy. So we see that there's big difference in mortality within these institutions. IMSS has a 44.8% mortality. And for example, in private hospitals, this goes down to 16.2%. But there's also the difference within these institutions in the different states. For example, we can see in Nuevo León, there's a huge difference between IMSS, that they have a mortality of 40%, and ISSSTE near 0%. And the mean is 30% because IMSS is really big. But we see another state, for example, Baja California Sur, where the effectiveness of all different institutions is really, really close, and there's no big difference between the maximum mortality and the minimum mortality of these different institutions. For example, doing some research, we found that Baja California Sur has a really good mechanism of coordination within these institutions, and they basically share all their resources, from doctors to medicines, from equipment. And there are other states where these different institutions don't even talk within each other. We made a profit model in two steps. The first step has a dependent variable, which is the if you were hospitalized or not. And this first step is focused on determining what's the probability of someone to require hospitalization, depending on their personal characteristics. So we found these are the coefficients of all the significant variables in the model. We found out that the elderly people that are over 60 is the main variable that has the biggest effect, then renal insufficiency, then diabetes, and the other ones also affect the probability of being hospitalized, but elderly renal insufficiency and the diabetes are the ones that if you have them, you are more probable that if you get infected with COVID, you will become hospitalized. Then the estimated parameter of the probability of being hospitalized from this first step of the model, we introduced it in the second step model, and then we put in the model more variables of things that happen in the hospital. So we are controlling for all the personal characteristics that these people had when they were infected with COVID. And we found that if you are if you go to the IMSS institution, it has the highest impact on increasing the probability of dying. Then the state level institutions, which is SSA, then there's the different other medical institutions we talked about. The availability of doctors, as you have more doctors available, that decreases the probability of dying. And also the time you take since you start the symptoms, since in Mexico, the average is to wait 4 days since you started symptoms to go to the hospital or the medical unit. This is something that is also affecting. And we also found out that there's a statistical significance on difference between all the Mexican states, that some of them can treat you better than others. For example, if you go to a hospital in Tlaxcala, your probability of dying increases way more than if you go to the hospital, for example, in Nuevo León or Querétaro, that are in the lower side of the table at the right. And we made some counterfactual examples of how this data from the model can be used. because the coefficients sometimes are difficult to interpret. So a man with diabetes that is over 60 years old and is treated at the IMS of Morelos has 65.6% probability of dying. But if he would to be treated at the same medical institution, but at Mexico City, it would be 62. That's a 5% reduction in the probability of dying. A woman with the hypertension at IMS, if she is treated in Mexico City, instead of going to IMS, if she was treated at another hospital at ISSSTE, she would have a reduction in the probability of dying of 35%. That's the biggest reduction we've seen in these examples. Then another example, a man with kidney failure treated at IMS that waited a week to receive medical attention. If instead of waiting 1 week, waited only 1 day, would have a 7.3% reduction in the probability of dying. And the last example, a woman over 60 years old with diabetes treated at the IMS at Baja California. If in a long-term policy, we start fighting diabetes, that's also a huge impact in mortality. This would mean a 22.1% reduction. So in conclusion, as we've seen, there are big differences in the effectiveness of treating patients within Mexican health institutions and also at the state level. If we would all perform as well as the best five states, we would have in Mexico 15% less deaths in the country, 15% less than the 90,000 we have already is a lot. So meanwhile, while the vaccine is fully deployed and most of the population is vaccinated, it is really important, as we've seen in other sessions, that the contagion prevention measures are the best way to prevent mortality, such as testing, reinforcing on communication so people are disciplined and take care for each other. Another conclusion of this specific study is that in Mexico, renal insufficiency, diabetes, immunosuppression, and the elderly are the ones that are more affected by COVID. And because of the difference we've seen, which not only go to difference on resources and equipment that the states and the hospitals have, also on communication, coordination, and on the care protocols, that we've seen some hospitals even recommend treatments and medicine that other hospitals say it's not good to use, then it would be really, really effective in Mexico for everyone to move to the best practices, since this would have a huge effect reducing mortality. So that would be it. Thank you very much. And I'll return the word to David.
Thank you so much, Emilio. Really interesting talk. Just real quickly, I have a question for you. It seems like from your recommendations, there are certainly things that will take a lot longer to, you know, act on, like reducing some of the comorbidities. That's a long-term challenge in Mexico. But certain things like coordination within a state, for instance, could potentially happen within the timeframe of COVID-19. Are you interacting with any of the health officials to convey the value of coordination or those types of findings, or is this more of just an academic study at this point?
No, we did some work, and our consultancy firm, we did some pro bono work with most of the states in Mexico, and this is where we found some of the best practices that we are working on sharing with the other states that are doing worse, since, as you said, David, most of the policy actions will take more time to develop. Changing the testing strategy in Mexico at the federal level looks kind of difficult because there are some ideological issues that are hard to change. But these short-term actions, we are trying to help on states adopting them. Another thing that could be implemented also easily is not only working on better coordination, also on sharing the best protocols on medical attention, since not all institutions have them. And since there's not much availability of doctors, most of them are not really specialized in treating COVID patients. So there's also a need for constant capacitation of the doctor.
Have you seen a change in mortality over time? I know in the United States, for instance, it's been a lot learned, and mortality is down because we've learned better how to treat patients. Are you seeing those same patterns in Mexico as well? I don't recall seeing trends over time.
Yes, in Mexico, it's also reducing, even though that the cases are growing, mortality is falling. In part of what, because of what you mentioned, that there's some learning curve, but also because people that are infected right now are younger, so they have less probability of dying because they got back to work, or the youngest people are the ones that are taking less care of themselves and socializing and going to parties and stuff like that.
That's great. Let me open this up to the discussion in the last couple minutes to anyone who has questions for any of the presenters.
Hi. I had a question for the second presenter. Mm-hmm. I was thinking that the next virus might be, well, probably won't be a coronavirus, and having tools like the one described in place beforehand that were like disease neutral and could be used for a range of epidemiological data would be useful, and what would the challenges be of creating something like that?
Well, I think the idea of using a utility function that is robust against different worldviews will apply to things even more than just pandemics. Like any public policy, I think, where there's big disagreement in what values to consider, we could use this. If you're looking at a different pandemic, it's going to be just down to the specifics. If it's another respiratory pandemic, a lot of the uncertainties are going to be roughly the same. If it's like a sexually transmitted disease or something, if it's an AIDS epidemic or something similar, wearing masks is not going to be as useful against that, for example. So that whole section of the model doesn't work. But the general methodology behind it, I think, is useful in a lot of different situations.
I guess I was asking about the possibility of creating something when you don't know what the pandemic will be, where you don't yet have any of the data, you don't know if it's respiratory or something else, and you want something before a pandemic hits, which is applicable in like a vast variety of situations.
Yeah,
that's, we should definitely be prepared for that. That's something that I think the United States was not prepared for at all. I can't speak for a lot of the other countries. Or if we did have any preparation, I think it was sabotaged somewhat by the current administration, but that's kind of veering into politics a little bit.
Yeah. May I make a comment on this? I think that one thing that we learned at the onset of COVID-19, very quickly, we had information about how cases were trending in different areas, and there are a lot of dashboards and interactives that were available for people to see where is the disease, how is the disease progressing. But it took time for the research organizations, and including RAND, where I work, to take that information and couple it with the economic models. And that's some of the work that we've seen here is that takes some time to get that coupling together. But then I think what we're learning, as we progress through this disease, is it's not just understanding the trade-off between, mortality and economics, that there's also all this social behavior that is really, I don't think we anticipated it playing such a role. So I guess I would think that as this pandemic winds down, there's going to be a new base of knowledge that we can apply and have, models and frameworks ready to quickly spin up, tools and that could be used for, a next pandemic, and bring those policy levers and those social levers into the equation right away. So that would be some thoughts on that. Anyone else have any other comments? All right. Go ahead.
Well, just a question. I mean, we have seen these beautiful adaptive plans and utility functions and statistics and so on. So now the main question, of course, is how do we get these people in practice, these planners in practice, willing to use this in a proper way?
Yeah, well, I have not seen what our pandemic response plan from the previous administration. I have not seen sort of a gamed out what would the response to this pandemic had been had we followed that plan, because that was not, of course, followed in this, in the United States. But I think that would be really interesting. But of course, it depends so much on who's making the decisions. And
yes. You're putting it nicely, David. It was thrown in the garbage.
That's what I heard from the CDC or something. They had a sort of a plan place. And
Obama administration had a plan, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, maybe, I mean, yes, but there are other places where, that did not happen. And can we, what can we say about the plans that were in place in other places like the Netherlands? I don't know. This is just a question.
No, I was thinking of Vietnam and Korea.
Yeah, I did mention some other countries that did have a plan and did immediately act.
Yep.
Yeah, no, actually, that reminds me of a question that I was thinking about, Warren, when you were talking, is how transferable are those types of plans in, like, say, Vietnam to the U.S. context? Of course, U.S. politics is messier, and there's a lot more diversity and also it's larger and distributed, decision making. Do you see that, the kinds of, responses that were made in Vietnam could have played out in the United States had we either known to do so, or had a different political context where things were a little bit more cooperative, et cetera?
Well, certainly action would have been taken earlier. As you know from Woodward's book, the president knew how serious it could be in the end of January, beginning of February, and took no action for over a month.
Right.
So I think action could have been taken. There would be pushback. I mean, Americans like their liberty, and they will protest against lockdown. But I think that it would have made a difference had they had the plan in place and acted earlier.
Yeah. Hey, Jack, speaking of liberty and willingness, I was thinking during your talk, have you run across any studies that actually looked at willingness to pay for wearing a mask or not wearing a mask? I see a potential disconnect between the rhetoric of how terrible wearing masks are versus what people would actually be willing to pay not to wear a mask, or et cetera.
I have not seen that. I looked for it briefly, but I think we might have been too soon. That question would have never come up until, just a few months ago. But that would be an interesting side project.
I also wouldn't trust the responses given the the accuracy of our polling in this country. But I think it is a really important question. I mean, especially if you're going to try to make decisions based on some sort of implied cost of these, quote, low cost non-pharmaceutical interventions like mask wearing, which has so much potential effectiveness.
Another related point to that, Dr. Lumford mentioned in one of his talks that you have to kind of you have to constrain possible worldviews somehow. You can't just take in every worldview, and some just don't make sense. Like, if you're valuing wearing a mask at 10 times more than someone else's life, like that's not feasible. I mean, yeah. At what point does the government have to say, look, we cannot listen to, we have to put reasonable bounds. We can't listen to every crazy person.
Right. Yeah, well, I mean, in some ways, the DMBU can try to highlight, where there's insensitivity to those views, and then when there actually are true trade-offs, and illuminating what you really have to believe in order to, in order to oppose a national or whatever regional mask mandate, by the numbers, you would probably have to value your liberty extremely high and probably very close to the cost of a life, and and undervalue economy, because by not wearing masks, you're gonna have to shut down the economy earlier, et cetera. So I think that's actually an area where, the kind of work that you're doing, I think it's really interesting to put everything into a single objective or utility function and see what floats up to the top, but it's really helpful to be able to unpack that and see, well, what's contributing to that. And then of course that gets to more of the multi-attribute work. So I often think of the two approaches as being nicely done hand in hand, because they do provide different information that can be useful. So, all right, any other comments?
One other thing about what we did wrong in the United States and what was done right other places is that there could have been better leadership. And Donald Trump could have said, wear a mask, and not said, don't wear a mask. If you look at New Zealand also, they had great leadership there. Okay, it's a small island country, but countries that had strong leaders and had strong rules, it worked.
Very good point. All right. Well, thank you all so much. Thank you so much to the speakers. I think this is a great collection of talks and a nice way to round off the sessions on COVID-19. And I guess I would encourage everybody to listen to the talks in the first session if you didn't get a chance to. I think those should be posted soon. And yeah, thank you so much.